الله أكبر الله أكبر.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to Beacon of Truth, program designed to discuss the teachings of Ahmadiyyat and to dispel any allegations imposed on Jama'at Ahmadiyya. But before I would introduce our panel today and the topic for today, I just want to reiterate the fact that this is your program. It's an interactive program. What would you like to see on this? Give us your feedback. beacon@mta.tv. With us today in the studio we have on the panel, to the right we have Atta'un Sisa. Assalamu alaikum Ramtullah. To the left we have Shazad Saab. Assalamu alaikum. And in the middle today we have Qasid Saab. Assalamu alaikum Ramtullah. And glad you could join us. I'd like to thank the studio audience who could be take their time out to be a part of the program. Assalamu alaikum. And the viewers at home, welcome. Now today's topic, again, is a very sensitive one. To an outsider, it may seem that Jama'at has created its own terminology. We have different names for different activities, for different subdivisions. We have Khuddam-ul-Ahmadiyya, we have Ansarullah, we have our own Majlis Ashura. It may seem that these are our innovations, and that has nothing to do with Islam. Now, we will discuss at length what the reality is, in fact. I'm going straight to the first question. I'll pose that to Shazad Saab. Shazad, could you tell us, why is it that we have our own terminology? I mean, does it have anything to do with Islam at all? Khuddam-ul-Ahmadiyya, as I mentioned, could you brief us on that?
Well, Zafir, out of the many features of a cult, if we take that allegation that's leveled against us, out of the many features of a cult, such as, you know, there's idolizing of one particular person, there's the process of excommunication, there's also, you know, them being very secretive and not questioning authority. One of the features also is the that, you know, there is use of such terminology and terms that anyone outside of that will not understand. Now, similarly, it is true that the Jama'at also makes use of certain terms and terminologies that, yes, maybe an outsider may not understand them. Now, the fact of the matter is that if you take any organization or any community for that matter, you will find that they make use of certain terms and terminologies for, you know, for particular roles and for particular departments for the purpose of efficiency, for discipline, and for the smooth running of their affairs. That does not mean that they are a cult or, you know, or in our case that it's an innovation or something un-Islamic. Now, for instance, if we take the example of a hospital, now to me, a common man, you know, a hospital is a place that's filled with doctors, patients, nurses. Yet when you look at it closely, you will come to find that just within the doctors, you have doctors such as consultants, you have surgeons, you have house doctors, registrars, senior registrars, and the list goes on. Because we don't understand them, that does not mean that, you know, the NHS that, you know, is primarily looking out there for your welfare and your health is a cult. Similarly, Jama'at Ahmadiyya also is a community that looks and takes care of the welfare of the community and far beyond. Now, that does not mean that we are also or should be labeled as a cult. Now, coming back onto the point that even in the earlier programs we had discussed that the Jama'at is not a separate entity from Islam, and such you know, terms and terminologies you will find in early Islam as well. Now, if we take the example of a non-Arab who comes to Medina at the time of the Holy Prophet and wants to become a Muslim, you know, he will recite his kalima, he will become a Muslim. Yet in spite of all of this, he will find that there are some Muslims that are known as the Muhajireen, some are known as the Ansar. He will find that some Muslims are known as the Ashab-e-Sufa, some are known as the Katibin-e-Wahi, some are known as the Hufaz, some are known as the Ashra-Mubashra. These are various terms and terminologies that are used for their particular role in society. Now, similarly, Jama'at also, for the purpose of efficiency and smooth running of its affairs, uses these terms and terminologies. So, to label us on this particular reason that, you know, we have created innovation or we are a cult is absolutely, you know, is baseless. Now, one thing I would like to mention here is that an allegation related to this is that we make use of certain terms and terminologies such as, you know, Khuddam-ul-Ahmadiyya, Ansarullah, Atfal, and so on and so forth. that is, you know, un-Islamic. You know, we don't derive them from the Quran or the Hadith. Well, firstly, that's wrong because one of the terms that I just used, Ansarullah, we find that in the Holy Quran, Nahnu Ansarullah. But, however, there's also, it's not the, you know, the point that we don't want to not use these particular words, but we are at times forced not to use these words. In certain countries, you know, constitutionally, we are not allowed to use these words, such as Pakistan. You know, there have been amendments in the laws that prevent us from using such terms because they say we are acting like Muslims or we are acting, you know, that's not the matter of that we don't want to use them, but we actually forced not to use them. For instance, the department that is, when it was initially set up, it was actually known as Nizarat Dawatul Tabligh. However, because the mullahs at the time started to complain and say that, you know, we are acting like Muslims and this is Islamic terminology, we therefore had to change it to Nizarat Islah Irshad. So the confusion doesn't lie on our place, but it's actually them who force us to not use such terminologies and stuff.
JazakAllah for that answer. Qasab, linking on to this question of terminology, we also see in the Jama'at that we've got various traditions that we uphold. Every year we celebrate Yom-e-Khilafat, we celebrate Yom-e-Masih-e-Maud. So I'd just like to ask, these various traditions, I mean, why do we actually celebrate these?
Yeah, Zafar, these traditions, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, these actual traditions, there are various other traditions apart from this, but one begins to ponder that why does one want to assert allegations against these traditions which don't really seem to be, you know, something worthy of asserting allegations against? I'll give you a few examples. As you said, there are certain occasions we in the Jama'at Ahmadiyya celebrate. There is Jalsa Yom-e-Khilafat, first of all. Now, we have to understand why do we celebrate that? We should always ask ourselves when that day comes, and throughout the year, we should ask ourselves what this day connotes. That day is celebrated on the 27th of May of every year. And the reason for this is because the 27th of May in 1908, Hazrat Khalifa-tul-Masih, the first Khalifa, the first successor after the servant of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian Alayhi Salatu Wasallam, was elected. And the divine, the second manifestation of God's mercy came upon man. And God showed to man that I'm not going to leave you, I am going to be with you till the last day, the day of resurrection. I am going to help you. And through Khilafat Ahmadiyya, we see that the Jama'at is being helped day in and day out. And not only this, the Holy Prophet's grand prophecy, which he claimed 1400 years ago, he said that ثُمَّ تَكُونُ خِلَافَةٌ عَلَى مِنْهَاجِ النَّبُوَةِ, that there will be Khilafat, successorship on the precepts of prophethood, and that will remain until he remained silent. But that connotes his definition that this will continue forever until the last day, that Khilafat will remain. And this, we celebrate the Yom-e-Khilafat because Khilafat was foretold by the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Similarly, we have Jalsa Yom-e-Masih-e-Maud Alayhi Salatu Wasallam. Again, we are celebrating that grand prophecy which was made 1400 years ago in a humble dwelling of Mecca, in which he said that a person will, if faith was to rise up to the Pleiades, a star in heaven, a person will bring that back down who will be of Persian descent. And we see that the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian, we believe him to be that person who brought that faith back down and is instilled in our hearts, in your hearts, in the hearts of Ahmadiyya Muslims all over the world. That is why we celebrate, to pay gratitude to Allah the Almighty that he has given us this divine way of attaining God's nearness. These are just some of the days which we celebrate. There are other traditions now which in the Jama'at we have, which should also be answered. I've got some off the top of my head. I would like the audience also, if you do think of any, I've only brainstormed a few. If you do think of any, please let me know during the program, inshallah, we'll try to answer those traditions. Now, the first tradition which comes into mind is, as Ahmadi Muslims, we show and express our love for Hazrat Khalifa al-Masih. How do we show it? We kiss his hand. We, whenever he meets us, we bow and kiss his hand. But not everyone does this. Now, this has become a point of allegation, but it doesn't really make sense. Why? Because in the time of the Holy Prophet ﷺ, we see that not only did people kiss his hand, people kissed his feet, who only became a Muslim a few days ago. A person came and started kissing the feet of the Holy Prophet ﷺ. Not only that, a person, a companion of the Prophet, came up to him and said, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's a long story, I'll cut it short. He lifted his shirt from his back, and he was so, you know, in love with the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he began kissing the Prophet's back. So if you're going to assert allegations against this, then God forbid you're going to be asserting allegations against the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whoever asserts allegations against such traditions.
If you could just elaborate on one tradition. I was watching a video recently in which a certain individual claimed that our Jalsa Salana, right, the annual gathering that
yes,
we have every year, that we supersedes the Hajj, and for us as Ahmadis. Okay. If you could just clarify this allegation and what is the Jalsa Salana?
This is very simple to understand, because we as Ahmadis, I being an Ahmadi, I'm going to say that we all say that Jalsa is in its own place and Hajj has its own divine place. Jalsa, the main purpose for Jalsa wasn't for for people to get together as people do in Hajj, but it was to develop a sense of brotherhood amongst the people and for people to come together and seek divine spirituality from the companionship of the promised Messiah والسلام, at that time, or the Khalifa of the time. I think all of us, when we go to Hadikatul-Mahdi to go to the Jalsa, we always have, you know, we get that buzz in us that there is a spiritual thing going on. I sleep the night there, I sleep in a sleeping bag, and you know, I know that when I'm sleeping there, there is a person here who is praying for us constantly. Hazrat Khalifa-tul-Masih is praying for us constantly, and we are praying for him. And that spiritual atmosphere, those 3 days, they revive you throughout the year, with the spirituality that you need. So Hajj is a completely different, Hajj is like a kind of worship, basically, which Allah the Almighty has prescribed upon mankind in the Holy Quran. Jalsa Salana, on the other hand, is something which was formed by Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian, alayhi salatu wasalam, in 1891 to develop a sense of brotherhood. It was more of a meeting up actually at that time, because only 75 people, I think, took part in that Jalsa. So these are two completely different things. They shouldn't be confused.
Even for a second, think that we could give precedence to Jalsa over Hajj. Hajj is a basic pillar of our faith.
Definitely.
Now, Nasisa, moving over to you, if I could just ask a very sensitive topic. It may actually even creep into the minds of many Ahmadis, but they may not feel comfortable just expressing themselves. So we would like to use this platform to ask, why is it that we pay chanda? Now, some people say it's like a form of membership, that you have to pay chanda, then you'll be in the Jama'at. So why is it do we actually pay chanda?
And Jazakallah, Zafir. First of all, what we need to understand is that where is the base of chanda coming from? It is in the Holy Quran that one of the qualities of muttaqi is that وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ, that they spend out of that Allah Ta'ala has provided them. And again, it is in the Holy Quran that لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ, that you cannot achieve the highest level of piety unless you spend out of that which is dear to you. Then again, there are many other verses in the Holy Quran which become the base of this spending in the way of Allah. Now, if a person accepts Islam, and not Ahmadiyyat, I'm saying if a person just accepts Islam and it's the early period of Islam, and he's accepted Islam, and the, you know, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had at that time made some office bearers who used to go to people and request zakat, because it was prescribed at that time. That was the financial system prescribed by the Holy Quran, that khudh min amwalihim sadaqa. According to that, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to send people to, you know, those eligible members who had to pay zakat. If at that time somebody starts saying that I'm being forced to pay zakat. This was not part of my contract, my part of becoming a Muslim. I am a Muslim. I say La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, and if I don't pay the zakat, I'm being forced. And there was an incident as well that once, a Sahabi came to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said that, please pray for me that may Allah grant me wealth. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed for him. That prayer was accepted. Later on, when people, from who were the office bearers at that time, they went to him and requested for the zakat, he declined. As a result, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that nothing will be taken from him again. That was the punishment that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave, that even if it is, the loads of camels, lots of camels, which later we saw in the history that he used to camel, with I think lots of money and various other things, but they were not accepted by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, neither were they accepted by the Khulafa later on. So this was the practice of Islam. When the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came and the institution of zakat was established, at that time it was not the only institution present in Islam. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to launch various schemes for financial sacrifices as well. In Ghazwa-e Tabuk, we know that Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, he brought everything from his house, even the needles from the wall, he brought those as well, and spent in the way of Allah. Hazrat Umar brought half of his belongings from the house. Hazrat Usman sacrificed many camels, and I think it was 10,000 people that he armed at that time. So these were the sacrifices present at that time as well. Nowhere in the Holy Quran or in the traditions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has it been mentioned that there can't be another financial system. When the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam came, now that was according to the prophecies of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the Messiah was to come for the revival of the religion of Islam. And when the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam came, he could see that Islam was being attacked from all the corners, and so much wealth was being spent just for bringing harm to Islam. At that time, the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam started, he said to his followers that financial sacrifices should be made. And he said that if a person eats four breads, he should sacrifice one. That makes it 25% of a person's daily, whatever he eats, whatever belongs to him, 25% of that. Now, later on, and at the time of Hazrat Khalifa-tul-Masih Sani, an initial system was started that Chanda Aam should be taken from every earning member. Not every adult, but every earning member. And the percentage was 6.25%. And there are other chanda, like Chanda Vasiyat, which was started by the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam himself. And it is minimum is 10%, and the highest that a person can go to is one third, which is 33.33%. So all these come under the phase of that financial sacrifices that Holy Quran is asking. So it's nothing new, nothing that has been brought into Islam. It is what Islam actually taught us. Now, if a person cannot, let's say his circumstances are such that he cannot pay the chanda at the prescribed rate, then he has a door open, and that door should be used instead of putting allegations against Ahmadiyya that, oh, Ahmadiyya, they are, we are being forced to pay chanda, and why is this? The questions do come into the mind, but that is a form of jihad. If something is dear to us, maal is something that is dear to majority of people, not everyone. But we are that community that this maal is not dear to us at all. We would say that please take everything that we have, and for the sake of the revival of Islam. So that's the spirit that is among the Ahmadis. It's not difficult for me to pay the chanda, not difficult for anybody else present here most probably that it's not going to be that somebody will say that, oh, I can't pay the chanda. But if somebody is there who cannot pray according to the prescribed rate, the door is open that he can write to Khalifa-tul-Masih. As the Khalifa-tul-Masih, Ayatollah bin Nasir Aziz, does grant permission to those people who cannot pay according to the prescribed rate. If he cannot pay at all, he is given permission that, okay, don't pay at all. But with his prayers, and because that devotion is in the heart of that person, that I want to pay but I can't pay due to my circumstances, later on Allah Ta'ala does grant him ability to pay according to the prescribed rate or even more than that. And we have examples that people, you know, they save a little amount for themselves and pay the whole, you know, the rest amount completely for the sake of the service of Islam. I think early in the time of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, once there was some, at that time the financial system was not that organized. Now by the grace of Allah it is very organized. At that time the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, was in need of some money due to the case that was going on, that had been launched against him. And he wrote to one of his followers, Hazrat Khalifa Rashiduddin Sahib, and said that so much so money is required. I think the next day or the day before was his payday. He took all the income that he had received and sent it to Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam. And not only that month, for the next 6 months he kept on doing that. That's the practice which we have learned from the Sahaba of the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, and what they learned from the Sahaba of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, that they started giving everything. And that's the practice that we have.
That's a very concise, compact answer. Just one thing, before I open the floor to the audience, could you just tell us, are we actually bound to pay chanda? Are we forced to pay chanda?
Being obliged and being forced is totally different things. If we have joined the Ahmadiyya community, we have accepted the Promised Messiah to be that person who had come according to the prophecies of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when we accepted him, we made it incumbent upon ourselves that we will do financial sacrifices. This is a form of jihad. At the time of Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there were people who used to say that, oh, you know, when they were called for jihad, they would even leave at the time of battle. At the Battle of Uhud, there were 300 people who left under the leadership of Abdullah bin Ubay bin Sulul. And you know, there are many other examples that people, it was for certain people who were hypocrites at heart, it was difficult for them to pay the sacrifices that were required of them at that time. So once we join a divinely guided, a divine system, a divine religion, we have to make sacrifices. It is incumbent upon ourselves. We make it obliged on ourselves. Nobody else forces us. Yes, we are reminded, we are sent letters, we are told that, oh, this was your promise, so the time is passing, so please fulfill your promises. And it is a teaching of the Holy Quran that promises should be kept. And according to that, if you know, they are reminded again and again and again. Reminder is again a teaching of the Holy Quran that فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ. That was the, you know, commandment given to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So according to those commandments, if somebody is reminded, he's not being forced. Yes, he is being reminded that this is an obligation that you took on yourself to help the religion of Islam, help the revival of Islam. And because we know that it is being spent in the right manner, in the right place, so we do make sacrifices, and it is an obligation taken upon ourselves by ourselves. Nobody else is forcing us to do so. When we joined Ahmadiyya, that's what we said, that we are going to do that.
Financial sacrifice is not new to religion anyway. If we look religions in the past, there's always a theme of financial sacrifice.
Just to add on to what you just said, that there are whenever divine religion is sent by Allah Ta'ala, Allah Ta'ala is there for the support. Allah Ta'ala never leaves them because he's supporting them all the time. But there are some worldly means that are required. Those worldly means, they include the financial sacrifices. And that's why I think there are more than 55 verses in the Holy Quran. I was just going through them, and which clearly mention spending in the way of Allah. And there are many more which some way or another speak about the financial sacrifices.
Jazakallah for that very compact answer. I know we've already got some questions. Is gentleman in the back row, please.
Assalamu alaikum Abdullah. Coming back to our financial systems of the Jama'at, apart from calling us a cult, people, non-Ahmadi brothers will also call us a financial organization. And right. They'll say that because they assume that we think of Chanda as more important as than Zakat, whereas because Zakat is one of the pillars of Islam, and they say that we don't observe Zakat, but we observe Chanda Aam and all these other Chandas. So what would we reply to them?
That's a very valid question there. Honestly, I'd like to come to you that it's allegation that we give preference to our Chanda rather than Zakat, which is obviously prescribed by the Holy Prophet. So what would you have to say about this?
First thing is that it's not that we don't lay emphasis on Zakat. Zakat is the most prior thing. It's the priority of the Jama'at on an eligible person. Now there are points where a person is eligible to pay Zakat. Not everybody is eligible to pay Zakat. It's on your accumulative wealth that has been saved in the bank and not touched for the whole year. Or some of the farmers, they have to pay the Zakat. And the financial system is different in a sense that that has been given to the Jama'at so that everybody, each and every individual, can take part in the financial sacrifices. So it's not that we don't, emphasize on Zakat. If you look at the, normal our receipt books, the first and foremost thing that has been mentioned there is Zakat. So Zakat is taken, and we fully understand that Zakat is being used in the right places because of the blessings of Khilafat that we have. The other financial systems, the other, chandajat, which are chanda aam, chanda wasiyat, they are there as well to enhance our spirituality, for the purification of ourselves. So they are present there as well.
Okay, so Zakat is always given preference. It may not appear to some people than others. So I hope that satisfies your question. Anyone else? The gentleman in the middle row, please. What would you like to ask?
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi
wabarakatuh. Wa alaikum assalam
warahmatullahi. My question is that what is the main difference between Chanda Jalsa Salana and Tehrik-e-Jadid, Waqf-e-Jadid and Chanda Aam?
Right, so the differences between Tehrik-e-Jadid, Waqf-e-Aam, Sisa?
Chanda Aam is obligatory upon each and every, earning member. That's the Chanda Aam, which is 6.25% of one's income, monthly income, let's say. Chanda Jalsa Salana is also obligatory. It is used for the purpose of, the annual conventions that we hold. You see that how amazing the annual conventions that we have within UK, for example. We have witnessed it ourselves. Now, as far as the Chanda Tehrik-e-Jadid, Chanda Waqf-e-Jadid is concerned, they were launched later on by Promised Messiah, Hazrat Muslim Maud Rajiya Ta'ala Anhu. For example, Chanda Tehrik-e-Jadid was launched in 1934. Chanda Waqf-e-Jadid was launched in 1957. And they are the schemes for the revival of Islam, for the support of Islam in certain parts. For example, Chanda, I think it's going to be mentioned in a later program as well, that where this money is being spent in general. So I'll be brief about it, and whatever it's, there's no, let's say, obligation upon a person. Everybody is reminded, and each and every sincere Ahmadi tries his best to pay as much as he can towards these other schemes as well, which are launched at the time various times by Khulafa-e Ahmadiyya. So does that answer your question?
Satisfy your question? Jazakallah.
question previously. You said that non-Ahmadis, they call us a financial organization and we do everything through finance. Well, we should pose this question to them, because once I was actually sitting down on the television set and I was flicking through, and I saw, without any exaggeration, I saw about 3 to 4 channels who were, you know, in a way, I shouldn't say begging, but they were, you know, requesting for money, and the money wasn't for such appeals. Maybe some of them were for appeals in poorer countries, but I've seen some channels who sit there and they request for money for the survival of their channel, so that they may broadcast their channels throughout the year. Now, we as Ahmadis, we understand the sanctity and sacredness of Chanda Jat and the finance and this financial contributions and sacrifices. We don't go, we try not to go door to door and going, you know, give us your money, please give us some money. We have made it, in our pledges, we say that I will sacrifice my life, wealth, time and honor. Wealth comes in there. So we have readily already admitted that we are ready to give our wealth for the Jama'at. So when we've said that, when we've entered the Jama'at and entered an organization in such a manner that we've promised to say such things, to assert allegations against the Jama'at afterwards, it doesn't make any sense. You've already promised that you're going to give money. So to afterwards saying that, oh, I don't want to give this money anymore, then you shouldn't have promised initially.
If we were really after money, then when someone is excommunicated from the Jama'at, the first thing that normally happens is the jandars aren't accepted from him. Exactly. If we were really after money, we would continue to accept them and just tell them, you know, you can ask for forgiveness, but keep the jandar coming. We don't do that. Jandars are not taken from that individual. So that might...
Just to add to what you just said, even certain people who leave the Jama'at, when they ask for, you know, certain people have asked for their chanda back, and all their chanda have been given to them. You know, it has been returned to them, because Ahmadiyyat does not need the support of individual people. It is supported by Allah Ta'ala. If one person or, you know, some people are not, you know, helping Ahmadiyyat financially, Allah Ta'ala will bring, you know, a groups of people for the, you know, service of Islam.
For that addition. Anyone else would like to add? Gentleman in the back row. Yes.
Yes. As we discussed earlier, that we celebrate some days like Yom-e-Masih-e-Maud and Yom-e-Masih-e-Maud or Khilafat Day, but non-Ahmadis blame us that we don't celebrate the birth of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. In which sense we celebrate the birth of the Holy Prophet, or how we can, you know, let them know that we do celebrate the birth of the Holy Prophet as we celebrate
these
days?
That's a very, very valid question, and that's another allegation which is constantly raised, that we... And see if I could come back to you, that we don't celebrate the birth of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. If you could add to that, Jalsa, if you'd like to add on this.
Yeah. First and foremost, he said that, you know, whether we do or don't, well, the fact is that we do celebrate, you know, there's no hard and fast rule that, you know, we completely don't celebrate Eid Milad al-Nabi and stuff. I remember listening to a Waqf-e-No class when Hazur actually mentioned as well, he said that back in the days they actually used to do a charagha, I don't know exactly what it's called in English, lighting, that they, you know, there are mentions of that, you know, there was some sort of celebration. And the fact is that we also have Jalsa Siratul Nabi, and we celebrate in a very dignified manner. Yes, we do differentiate from the mainstream Muslims. We don't, you know, go out on the streets and, you know, cause mayhem and whatnot. You know, we get together and celebrate in a very dignified manner. And the fact is that for us, the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is not limited just to be remembered on one particular day. You know, yes, we do have those days where we celebrate it, but obviously we remember him for, you know, for the whole 365 days of the year. We remember him in our prayers. We remember him out of our prayers. We send durood on him as instructed.
Because remember, we all our lives we are there to protect and serve Islam. In the Indian subcontinent, it should be remembered that the Jama'at Ahmadiyya was one of the first to celebrate the Jalsa Sirat al-Nabi. When an individual wrote, it was a book regarding the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in which he talked, you know, really in an abusive manner. Now, our second Khalifa, Hazrat Muslim Maud at the time, stressed that, you know, we should, instead of going onto the streets and saying, oh, what has he done, you know, get him, you know, hang him, as was the case for the Muslims, Hazrat Muslim Maud, he said, no, we need to let the people know, let them be aware that this is actually the teaching of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is how he used to spend his life. And it could be, you know, some people may not be aware. And you see every year when we have our Jalsa Sirat al-Nabi, we invite our guests, our local neighbors, and they say, we never knew about this. You know, we've never seen this side, because the media has portrayed it in such a way that they've portrayed the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as something completely different to what he actually was. So remember, we were the first, one of the first in the Indian subcontinent to actually celebrate Jalsa Sirat al-Nabi. So, anyone else would like to? Gentleman in the front row on the right.
My question is regarding election of Khulafa-tul-Masih. One of my Gharam Desi friend asked me this question, that is the election of Khalifa-tul-Masih is the same the way Khulafa-e-Rashideen were elected?
Right. So,
and if it's different, then who and how it was started, and who explained this to?
Right. So how is the Khalifa elected, and is it similar to the Khilafat of? If I could. Qasidov, if you would like to expand on this?
In that time, we see that the span of Khilafat was about 30 years. And Islam, the number of people in Islam at that time were very, don't get me wrong, they were very large. It was a very large number. But when we see in Ahmadiyyat, we see that in the first Khilafat, there was no election. It was unanimously agreed that Hazrat Hakim Maulana Nuruddin Sahib Razeelahu Ta'ala Anhu should be elected as the first successor of the promised Messiah. Similarly, we see that in 1914, that was in 1908. Now in 1914, after a span of a few years only, Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmad Sahib Razeelahu Ta'ala Anhu was elected as the second successor of the promised Messiah. So when these two, the first successor had passed on, and the second successor was Khalifa, and his Khilafat started in 1914 and ended in, I think, the 1965. So it was such a long period, and in his Khilafat, he was the one who formed that electoral committee, because the Jama'at had spread so far and wide in that time that he knew that unanimous decisions might be a bit difficult, and there needs to be such a electoral college who can sit down collectively and elect a Khalifa. And that is what we see even today. The third, fourth, and fifth successors of the promised Messiah were elected in this way, through a electoral college, in which the elders of the Jama'at, the people who hold offices in the Jama'at, and selected people of the Jama'at, they come together, they pray, and a Khalifa is elected unanimously at that. If there is not a unanimous decision, then it will happen again until there is a unanimous decision.
Sisab, if you'd like to just add something on that.
I would just like to add something to what the reply that Qasidov has given, that the authority that we take it from is from the life of the Sahaba. The way the Khulafa-e Rashideen were elected, Hazrat Khalifa Awwal, Khalifa Rashid, was Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. He was elected unanimously by the Sahaba of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There were other names presented, but later on he was elected by the Sahaba. Hazrat Umar's name was presented by Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, and he had spoken to Sahaba prior to his election. It was during the lifetime of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu anhu that Hazrat Umar was elected Khalifa, Khalifa Sani, and the authority was that he had consulted the Sahaba prior to his election. But in the time of Hazrat Umar radiyallahu anhu, the electoral system started. The beginning was that seven Sahaba were appointed by Hazrat Umar radiyallahu anhu, that you are going to appoint Khalifa. So later on, they sat down, they discussed, they consulted, and one of them, Hazrat Usman radiyallahu anhu, was elected as Khalifa Thalith. So the authority is taken from the example of Islam in the start. Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Sani radiyallahu anhu, when he saw that the Jama'at is expanded so much, now we number in millions, can all the people come together at one place and then elect a Khalifa? Definitely their representatives could come at one place and they could elect a Khalifa, and those representatives were elected by the members themselves. So in the Shura of Jama'at, let's say at a Jama'at level, at a country level, an Amir is elected, and an Amir is elected by the representatives which come from various parts of the country, and they are elected by the local people. So in actual fact, all the people are electing the Khalifa, but the election, it seems that physically people are electing the Khalifa, but in actual fact, it is Allah Ta'ala who is putting in the hearts of people that choose this one, choose this one. He is the Khalifa. So in that manner, the representatives, they elect a Khalifa according to the wishes of Allah Ta'ala.
With that addition, there's a question in the front row. What would you like to ask, sir?
My question is, as you mentioned earlier, we have our Qadha board in Jama'at. Can you please brief introduction of Qadha board?
Do you understand the question?
It is, I think he has asked about the Qadha board.
Qadha board.
Do you want clarification?
Do you want why do we have the Qadha board? Why do we have the Qadha board?
Your question is about Qadha board. This is an institution which exists in our Jama'at, and the sole purpose behind its existence is that there can be issues within a community. Now, where there are three people standing, there can be issues. Within a community, there can be issues, there can be disputes, and we don't want to fight ourselves out of it. We are a peace-loving community. We love peace, we love harmony, and because of that, that institution exists in our community, that if there are two people who have a dispute among themselves, two brothers can have disputes among themselves. So if they have disputes, they can bring it to the institution which is available within the Jama'at, instead of going outside and making it a big issue. So they can come to the Qadha board which exists in the Jama'at, and then at that particular dispute can be decided according to the Islamic rules, Islamic laws. So that's the sole purpose of Qadha board being present in the Jama'at.
Jazakallah for expanding on that, Naseer Sahib. Is there, might have time for one last question. Gentleman in the far right, what would you like to ask?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
I have a question regarding the Chanda.
Right.
I understand what's being said about Chanda, what's been said. But why is it that someone who, for example, defaults for 6 months on their Chanda cannot take part in Jamaati elections?
Right. That's a good question. If I'd like to put that to us up, that's a very important question. So someone who falls back 6 months in the in areas of Chanda, they're not allowed to take part in the voting, for example, the local guide. So why is that, Caesar?
First and foremost thing is that a person who is righteous, that's the sole purpose behind an election of a person, that this is our leader because he's the one of, as far as our understanding concerns, we see him to be the most righteous among ourselves, right? This is the purpose behind it. One of the, you know, quality, as I mentioned earlier on in the beginning as well of the program, that one of the quality of a muttaqi, a righteous person, is that he spends out of what Allah Ta'ala has given it to him. So if that person is not paying his chanda, let's say for example for 6 months he hasn't paid for his chanda, he can't take part in the election, that shows completely that there is a lackness, there is a weakness that he's showing in his taqwa. That one of the things is spending in the way of Allah, he's not doing that, so he's not allowed to take part, and neither anyone can vote for him because he's showing that weakness in himself. So I hope that.
And remember, there can be some circumstances in someone's life where he may not be able to pay. He might have a genuine reason. So they, if I can understand, they seek permission in advance that I have this issue, and I will promise to pay in a certain amount of time. And if, as long as it's clarified with the Jama'at, then he's allowed to take part. And we've come to the end of our discussion. I would like to thank our panel. Jazakallah for coming, taking your time out today. And again, the audience, there's some very valid questions. and the viewers at home. Please don't forget to write to us. Any suggestions you have, any feedback, please keep it coming. beacon@mta.tv, the address will be at the screen. And in the next program, we will discuss something very key to this Jama'at. The allegation is always raised, okay, so we collect the chanda. Where does all that chanda go? So where does all your chanda go? In which departments does the Jama'at spend it? In which activities? We'll look further into the next program. Until then, Jazakumullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allahu. Allahu